Okay, so in this video I'm going to show you how to create this nice looking gauge using the Arduino UNO and the 16x2 character display. And it might look like this, or perhaps more like that with the classic blue display. But depending on the use display, you can get any color you want. So, let's get started. Now, before we touch Arduino, we'll be using the WOKWI, which is a free online Arduino emulator. And we will not be starting from scratch, because I can open documentation and I can see that there is already a 16x2 display. And what I'm looking for are some examples. So I'll scroll down in the page and look for the example section. And there is one which is called Liquid Crystal I2C Hello World, which is exactly what I'm looking for. So I'll open this one and run it. And you see that there is a display connected to the Arduino. And there's a very simple code which just sets the library to be Liquid Crystal I2C, then sets the display to be certain address and certain size, and then inside the setup it initializes the display, set a backlight, and set the cursor a few more times on different positions and prints out some text. Let's quickly fix the size of the display. So I will stop the simulation and move the display to the right side, and I will add a new display by clicking this plus button, typing in 16x2 and selecting the I2C version and just dragging it below the Arduino. And I will use the same connection, so ground goes to ground on the Arduino board, the VCC goes to 5 volts on the Arduino board, which is for example here, then the SDA, which is data, goes to A4, so SDA goes to A4, and finally S-clock, so clock goes to A5, so S-clock goes to A5, and I will just fix the color so they are not the same. I can delete the original display and try to run it one more time, and you can see it works, but of course we don't see all the text, which is fine because we'll replace it with our own text anyway. So I will get rid of most of the stuff and I will only keep one set cursor and one print. I will move this inside loop function, because inside the loop we want to print out the CPU value, which will go between 0 and 100. So I will create a new variable of the type integer that will be called CPU gauge, and inside the loop function I will just increase this by 1 by saying CPU gauge equals CPU gauge plus 1. And of course I don't want this to go over 100, so I will say that if the CPU gauge is bigger than 100, I will set it back to 0. Now, instead of printing the hello world, I will actually print the value of the CPU gauge. And let's see how this looks like. It's on the wrong position, it's a little bit too fast, and it also looks like that we are counting to 1000. That's another case. We are only changing a certain number of characters, but we are not clearing the display. And we can fix this in a few different ways. The easiest will be most likely just to print some empty characters. And also fix the cursor position to be on the left top of the screen by setting this to 00. And this looks much better. Let's slow down the drawing by adding a little bit of delay, for example 100 milliseconds, which will mean that it will update 10 times per second. And let's add a few more text. So let's say you want to draw the CPU before the value and the percentage after the value, print CPU. And on the end, I will just print the percentage sign, and let's rerun this. And that looks much better, except we want the numbers to always take up the same amount of space, not to jump around. So basically the numbers should be right aligned. And for this, we will use the sprintf function. So for that function, we need the helper buffer defined like that. And then we'll call a function which will say that inside the buffer, we want to put some characters, and we can type in text like this, or we can type in the percentage sign, and percentage D means decimal number, percentage S means string. Then we provide the variable names, and it will take the value of those variable names and put it into the string. Let's start with the character buffer, and we can just copy this piece of code into our code. So I'll just paste it in here, and let's just even paste this piece of code into our code, which is the sprintf function, and I will paste it after we set the cursor. So what we want to show is the string CPU, so I'll say CPU, and the value of the CPU gauge variable, so I'll say percentage sign D for decimal number, and inside the variable list I will copy the CPU gauge. After a string, we want to show the percentage sign, but the percentage is already used for defining the variables, so I have to use double percentage in order to show the percentage sign. Let's get rid of those two print functions, and instead of printing characters, we will just print the buffer content, like so, and let's rerun the simulation. And it looks the same, which is expected. So what we need to do is we need to put the number in between the percentage sign and the character D. So if we put in number 3, that will mean that we want the number to always take up 3 spaces. One space for numbers below 100 and no space for 100. Let's try this with Arduino, and for that you will need the Arduino UNO board, which you can get in a few different versions. And the important thing for us is where we will connect the I2C display. As you have seen in the emulator, we were using the analog pins A4 and A5, but there are actually two more pins that you can use, and those are the pins on the right top of the board. And you can see there are no labels for those two pins, but if I flip the board, you will see it says SDA and SCL, so serial data, serial clock for the I2C connection. Actually, for this board, you can see that those are labeled, so you will see SCL and SDA. So it's really up to you if you want to use those two pins or those two pins. It's easier to use those if you have those labeled, because you don't have to worry about if the A4 is clock or data. And I have this board, which is the UNO board from the Seed Studio. It actually has those groove connectors for connecting I2C devices. You can see those connectors if you have those, I don't. The last board that I have is the Arduino UNO Mini Limited Edition. It's a very tiny board, but in the same way, those two pins, if you flip the board, are labeled SDA and SCL, so you can use those pins as well. The second part of the equation is a 16x2 character display, and this is the most common one, which has the parallel connection, but if you flip the board, you will see there is the additional board, which converts the parallel connection into the I2C connection. The second option is this kind of display, which has both the parallel connection and the I2C connection on the same board, so you can easily use it in a breadboard and it takes less space. It also has the connectors for the I2C on both the bottom and top of the display, so you can use whatever most suits you the most. Once again, connecting the display should be simple, so the VCC or VDD goes to 5 volts, the ground or VSS goes to ground, the S clock, so S serial clock, goes either to pin A5 or the SCL, and the serial data, SDA, goes to either pin A4 or SDA. As you can see here, if you use the breadboard-friendly version of the display, the connections are much easier to trace. With everything connected, we can open Arduino IDE, and we need to start with installing the libraries. So I'll go to Tools, Manage Libraries, and here I will search for this Liquid Crystal I2C. So just type it in here and press the Enter key, and somewhere down below there should be the Liquid Crystal I2C. You can see I already have this installed, but if you don't, you have to click the Install button. The last piece of the puzzle is finding out the address for our I2C display. You can see that inside the emulator, the address is set to 0x27, but that might be different for our display. So inside the Arduino, the easiest way to find this out is to go to File, Examples, Wire Library, that should be pre-installed with Arduino UNO, and open the I2C scanner. Make sure that the Arduino is connected together with the display, select Tools, and set the right port for the Arduino UNO, and then click this upload button. Once everything is uploaded, open the serial monitor by clicking this button, and hopefully it will show us the address of our display, which in my case is 0x3f, so you can see it's different from the sketch. Now we can finally copy the code from the Arduino emulator into the Arduino IDE, make sure to set the right address, again this is 3f for my case, and hit the upload button. And this is how it looks like, so let's move to the fun part, which will be creating the custom gauge. Thankfully, there is also a sample sketch on the WOKWI website, which is this one, custom characters. And as you can see, we first need to create an array with zeros and ones. Then we call the create character function, where we specify the character value and the array. And you can have up to 8 custom characters, which you print simply by providing the hex code. If you don't want to type zeros and ones, you can also use this custom glyph generator. So we need 4 different parts for our gauge. We need the left part, we need the middle part, we need the right part, and we need the filled part. Let's copy the arrays into our code, like so. So I'll paste it maybe above the setup function. But what I will do is I will rename the names of those arrays so it's clear what's going on. So it will be gauge left, gauge center, gauge right, and gauge fill. Then we need to set the custom characters for the LCD, and we can also copy the piece of code from this website. So I'll just copy the create character functions and put this inside the setup function. But of course, since we have already renamed the names of the arrays, we need to use the same names. So gauge left, gauge center, gauge right, and gauge fill. Just to make sure that the characters are defined properly, we can also copy this write function from the website and construct the gauge manually. So after printing in buffer, I will set LCD write byte 0, which means gauge left, and then I will write byte 1, which means gauge center, and then byte 2, which means gauge right. And since we take 8 different characters for this left string, we are left with 8 characters for the gauge. I can copy the middle part 6 times, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, so it will be 8 characters in total. So let's rerun the simulation, and we should see a nice looking gauge, of course, fully static. Now when the gauge will be filled, the byte 0, 1 and 2 will be actually overwritten by the number 3, so let's try this one more time with value of 3 for the filled gauge, maybe like so, and this is how the gauge might look like. Let's delete most of this drawing code, and first we need to find out what is the value of one character in our display, and we know that we are counting from 0 to 100, so that means that we can calculate the one character value by saying float CPU gauge step equals 100 divided by number of characters, which is in our case 8. Then we need a loop to examine every single character, so I'll create a loop saying for integer y equals 0, while the y is lower than 8, I will increase it by 1. And we need an if statement where we will say that if the value of the CPU gauge is smaller than the CPU gauge step multiplied by the counter of the function, that means that the value is smaller than the step, so we will draw an empty character. And for now, let's just say that the empty character would be the middle part of the gauge, which is character number 1. And if this is not true, we will draw a filled gauge, which is of course only 1, and it is the character number 3. and we only need to add the left and right side of the gauge. For that, we need to add a few more if statements into drawing the empty gauge. So we can say if the y equals 0, that means that we are drawing the first character, which is the left side of the empty gauge, in other words, byte number 0. If the y equals 7, that means that we are drawing the last piece of the gauge, which is byte number 2. And in all the other cases, we are drawing the middle part of the gauge, which is byte number 1. Let me just make this look a little bit nicer and add those comments so we know what's going on. And that's how it looks like. Pretty cool, right? Now, if you want, you can copy everything and just replace the CPU with the GPU and make sure that you are starting on the second line, and you can have a second gauge to fill the entire display. Notice that I've also changed the if statement for the value to be smaller or equal to the step times y in order to show the left side of the empty gauge. Finally, here is a project running on the Arduino. We have a few different displays. I hope you like this tutorial. If you have any questions, please feel free to let me know in the comment section. If you have ideas for future videos, please let me know as well. Thank you very much for watching, and I hope to see you next time. Thanks and bye.